And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Good Shit Podcast. Woo! Welcome back, everybody.
What's going on?
What's going on? Howdy.
Hello.
Welcome back, Steve, as our DM for this role-playing session. We got the lovely host, Mark Zombie. And the co-host Joe Zombie 93 as well.
Deuce, deuce.
How y'all doing today?
Doing good. I'm pretty good.
Doing good. Yeah.
Good weekend so far. Well. Beautiful day outside.
Mm-hmm.
All the better reason to stay inside.
Frick yeah.
Play some role-playing games. If I could get into a basement right now that wasn't all gross, I would probably. Want to be in a basement for this.
Yeah, you do have a basement. It's all
role-playing games in the basement are pretty solid.
Yeah.
You can really lose track of time and space and just be completely transported to another world for longer than you'd like to admit.
There's no sun.
A pretty solid 5-6 hour long role-playing sessions in my basement before.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Good times.
good times.
We got A-Rad up in the chat.
Up in the chat, A-Rad. What's up? And welcome everybody else. Was hanging out around here as we are trying to do our very first role-playing session here.
Yes.
Doing a new thing.
Last session, which was 2 weeks ago, we learned a little bit about the fate system, which is what we're going to be playing on. And I got some links to share. We can share our notes document and whatnot if people want to see our character sheets.
Mm-hmm.
But we made our characters live on stream, and we're actually Steve has been preparing this campaign for us.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Just getting a couple of my notes ready before we start the session.
DJ Sarugi also dropping in 5 to 6 hours. Amateurs. I'm definitely an amateur over here. I know Joe's maybe a little bit of an amateur. Goose's backstory. I don't think he's an amateur.
Oh my god.
Yeah, check out
free
that
page.
Link.
Free page is not that long though.
If you're curious, I did drop that in the chat. You guys should be able to see it. You can look at our some of our stories are more fleshed out than others.
Yeah. I'm sorry, okay.
I think I can
also I had the pressure of like I need to make up a race and make up like a system and yeah, I mean, it's not fully fleshed out in a way, but still, like,
my experience as a DM is that there's always one person who comes to you and is like, here's my manuscript, and everyone else is like, yeah, I guess I'm a dwarf or something, I don't know. I was born in the mines of Drakthar, and, like, I was struck when I was 2, you wouldn't believe what happened to me, and everyone else is like, how old are you? Oh, good question, never thought of that, you know?
Turn to page 3.
Yeah.
I'm writing down my age as we say that right now, actually. So that doesn't come down to me.
Oh my god.
But yeah, damn, I'm excited.
Okay, so my experience with superhero stories, so like some of this is going to come off as maybe a little bit not what you expected, and I don't know, we can adjust as needed, is that I mostly read kind of the like more subversive things, like I like Watchmen and like,
yeah, that's me as
the
well,
Boys, that kind of thing. Okay, so if we're on board with that kind of angle, I don't need to change too much stuff, but you know, like, yeah. It's going to depend whether you punch someone and they sort of biff out of existence or whether you, like, you know, punch them and their neck snaps or, like, you know, like that kind of thing. So
it's so kind of, yeah, more like dark and gritty of superheroes, kind of.
Yeah, I tend to go more of the dark, gritty side of things, yeah, but yeah. I don't know what you'd prefer.
That's,
you know,
that, like, is what I prefer. Like, Watchmen,
I prefer as well.
My favorite.
Yeah.
Same, yeah.
And then I guess backing up real quick, we kind of already spoiled it, but, well, not spoiled it, but we are doing a superhero theme. That's with the fate system, we're free to do any kind of, you know, theme we want. Could have been Western. Who knows? Maybe next time this goes well.
Yeah.
We could do, you know, different themes and different characters. But this time it's going to be superheroes. And yeah. We've got our dice already.
Boom. Ooh.
I'm rolling on
nice
my life.
Rolling
my...
Sounds, everybody.
All right. So what you're going to basically lead the show here, Steve, or tell us what we need to be told.
Yeah. Whenever. So, You guys all basically got an invitation from Hawk Guy. Hawk Guy is sort of the, like, he's very much the, like, he's this rich guy, you think, you know, suspected he's some rich guy, but he's some unknown vigilante. Like, nobody knows who he actually is. There's lots of rumors about it. But, you know, he does mass crime fighting at night, and he sent out a letter to all of you guys saying that you need to meet at this warehouse at a specific time to join into this sort of, like, you know, if you all join forces together, it'll help lend you legitimacy. It'll make you guys all, you know, have more strength to be able to, like, help each other out instead of, like, sometimes stepping on each other's toes and whatever. So you guys, along with other people, were invited to meet at this warehouse. And when you show up, unfortunately, you open the door and there's immediately just this thick white gas that pours in, and you find the door locked behind you and you're unable to breathe and you find yourselves blacked out.
Oh, wow. Okay.
When you wake up, you find yourselves in a room, each of you chained to a chair with your arms tied behind your back. And in the room with you, you see Hawk Guy is also chained up, as well as Sugar Glider.
Okay.
And Arachno Boy. They're all in separate seats, and in the center, you see this tall, mysterious-looking figure in a suit. He looks at all of you and says, like, "Welcome to the game, heroes! I'm the Great Equalizer, and you are going to suffer under my commands!" And then what happens to you guys is all strange. You see that this sort of, like, glitches out, and you immediately find yourselves, each of you, in a separate room, woken up with goggles strapped onto your face. So you're unable to hear the rest of his proclamation.
Right, so we woke up with our hands tied in one place. We saw that little scene, and then we were like...
So it turns out that you're actually, like, you realize that you're in, like, you're under a mask, basically, and you actually are physically tied up. You're in a chair, but you have a mask on over your face.
Almost like a VR, VR kind of thing.
Exactly. So you're trapped in a VR prison, so, like, you don't actually see each other in real life or anything. But so that's what happens. So you find yourself, you're actually strapped in a chair. You find yourselves, like, having woken up, and, like, whatever mind control thing he was trying to do to you failed because each of you has kind of your own special mutant powers that prevented that from happening to you guys.
Okay.
So we're currently right now still trapped in his chair with his goggles on us right now.
Yes.
Yes.
Is that Crawl? Is that you? I hear someone's voice. I'm a little hazy.
So you're shouting out. So you do hear very dimly, echoing, like you're so in the room you're in, it echoes very strongly, and you can faintly hear someone else's voice in the room next to you. But it seems like you have very thick walls around you.
I was gonna be like, rocking the chair back and forth, he's like banging around. He's like trying to just kind of like get loose.
Okay, so that seems like something we could have you roll for. So you're trying to get loose.
Yeah,
what kind of approach are you using for that?
I'm guessing forceful because I'm a forceful. Is kind of like because I'm guessing like because the straps. I guess that I'm like strapped to the chair. How am I strapped really? Like. Is it just like sitting?
As far as you can tell, your arms are pretty tightly bound, but it seems like they're bound by some sort of like cloth or leather or rope, not like metal chains or anything.
Around my back or like around like a chair or like
behind
the arms?
Behind your back and around the chair.
Okay, okay. Yeah, then I'll try this like using my arms gonna like kind of like break through that basically, the force through that.
Okay, perfect. Can I have you roll for that?
Sure. Let's see here. Let's go quickly over here. My backstory is way too long. There we go.
Scroll.
I would never say such a thing, dude.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Sure, what's up?
Now, like, for, like, instances like this where we're kind of just, like, doing whatever, can I do, like, internal dialogue?
Or not? Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, you can do that.
Like, no one else can hear me, but would it be good to, like, because my character is kind of like, you know, not forceful, kind of chill. He's just like
calculating,
silent right now, and just like calculating everything, listening to everything.
Yeah.
But I was gonna do like internal dialogue, just so I'm not just like.
Yeah, you say like what you're thinking. Yeah, and it's not like your character's necessarily vocalizing it.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right. I pretty much just in your is it Zach Crawl? Am I saying that right, Goose? Zach Crawl.
I will. Should I say how you pronounce it now, or should I said once.
I mean, I was asking you how to pronounce. I was trying to say your name at the beginning, and you didn't respond to me. So
Zikram.
I don't think you guys know each other yet.
But yeah.
Oh, we don't know each other.
You guys were saying that you didn't know each other.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
okay,
the thing. Right. That's the thing, because I don't think we know each other. That's the thing that I also got, that we don't really know each other.
So
because we got this letter to just like, oh, join forces. We're gonna blah 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 do this thing basically.
So I was rambling.
Yeah. So like you've like seen each other like walking into the like you all got like kind of ambushed at the same time.
Yeah. Like you figure like oh yeah, I guess like this dude is with me. I presume. I don't know. Like, yeah. Okay. So I'm rolling. So I have 3 in forceful. So just roll 3 dice or do you roll additional? Is there an additional?
You roll.
Dice?
So you always roll all 4 of your dice.
You always have one dice, just like no matter.
Minus 4 to plus 4 on your roll based on how your dice turn out.
Do you always have one? If you have like say 0 in a approach, you always still have like one dice to use.
You always roll all 4 of your dice.
Okay, so always
plus. It's just like your baseline. Like you have minus.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Okay, then I understand. Okay, then it's
you're starting at plus 3, and then it's gonna be modified up or down based on your dice. So like, I'm gonna let you know that like to break these straps, it's going to require some kind of a plus 4 roll. So like you need to get plus 1 total on your roll to like break free of this.
Okay, I'm gonna be rolling. Let's see.
Oh. The first roll of the session, guys.
Yep. I have 2 minus, I have, let's see here, 1 blank. And then, no wait, 2 blanks actually. So, and then I have like, what, 3 and 4 scroll. That gets me like 1 in total? 1 plus? Because I get minus 2.
So let me look at this real quick. So the action you're trying to do is to overcome an obstacle.
Yeah.
So you got...
I got a 1 and a 2, and that's a minus. Both of them are minus. If I read the fate system correctly, like 1 or 2
so
or minus.
So plus 3, and then you have what, minus? So you got 2 minus, a neutral, and a plus 1, you said?
2 minus, 2 neutrals.
2 minus 2 neutrals. So you have a plus 1 total.
Yeah, total.
Okay,
yeah.
Let me look at real quick. I'm just going to compare this to. Okay, so you're trying to overcome an obstacle right now. So you can use the overcome action when you have to get past something that's between you and a particular goal. Picking a lock, escaping from handcuffs, leaping across a chasm, etc. So, if you fail, you have a tough choice to make. You can simply fail, the door is still locked, the thug still stands between you, etc. Or you can succeed, but at a serious cost. So, that's up to you. And then once you decide whether you want to succeed on a cost or not, I can help you figure out what would be an appropriate cost. So it's not going to be like I just incur something on you, but you know, it's
I just lost but both of my legs. Like,
yeah, like it's not going to be like like you escape, but your arms fall off. Like, you know, it's not going to be anything that bad. But.
No, this is fucking sick, Kral. He's just going to do it with risk. Fuck it.
Okay, so I'm going to say that your risk is going to be that you snap out of the things, but you snap out with such force that you like fall over in the chair, which makes a really loud echoing clanging sound.
Yeah.
And you probably assume alerts any guards outside.
Yeah. I'm totally fine with that.
And then we can still hear stuff, right? It's just there's a goggles on our eyes.
Yeah. But like it does sound like there's not a lot of noise going on. Like you can kind of like it seems like you're sort of in like a muted area, and like you notice that the environment around you is pretty cold. Like it feels like it's almost like refrigerated temperature.
Oh, okay.
Now, being startled by the loud noise and the whole situation, because I'm sketchy about it, because I don't know why I would get an invitation to something of this nature.
Mm-hmm.
Being a low key guy myself and not really on the radar for anyone that I thought.
No one's off the radar of the hawk guy. Come on.
Exactly. I guess so. Jeez. I have big question marks by him. Let me just say that. But I use one of my powers, turn into a thick black smoke, and now do I roll? Like, how does this work now?
Yeah, how does abilities work exactly?
Okay, so abilities aren't... So invoking an aspect would be kind of what you're doing there. So like...
Yeah.
Invoking an aspect, you have to give up one of your fate points, but then you get to use your aspect, which in this case would be like, you know, your like a ghost aspect is basically where you have the ability to like turn into like smoke and do like your stealthy thing. It's kind of like your mutant powers are mostly held under that like a ghost aspect. So you can invoke that to let you modify your roll in several ways. So you can either give yourself a reroll, give yourself plus two to a roll, give an ally plus two to a roll. If there's some way that you can like, you know, say that like, oh, I'm going to turn into black smoke and like wrap myself around my ally so that like they're not going to get shot or something like that, you know, like yeah, whatever yeah. it would be. In this case, you'd want to turn into your black smoke to help you overcome your obstacle of escaping. So basically, like, you'd have to spend one of your fate points. So you start with 3 fate points. You'd be down to 2 fate points now. But then you'd activate your ability. You get plus 2 to your roll, and you'd be able to, like, whatever approach you use to escape, you now get to add plus 2 to your baseline for that. So
I got to decide if I want to do that right now, because the fate point's pretty huge, right?
Well, you will.
You already did it, right?
I mean, yeah, shit, I did it.
That's how you would do that. That's basically how a power of yours would work. Because you're invoking an aspect of yourself to give yourself advantage in a situation, but you're still doing like the basic roles. It doesn't take the place of doing one of your 4 actions. So your actions, just to go over that again, are you can create an advantage. You can... you can overcome an obstacle, you can attack something, you can defend something, or you can get help.
Overcome, obstacle, attack, get help?
Actually, I guess attack isn't really, get help isn't actually a thing. Get help is just a separate thing. So there's 4 actions you can take, or 5 actions you can take. Defend isn't really an action you take, it's something you take in response to something.
Okay. So create an advantage, overcome an obstacle, then what were the others?
Discord. I threw it in Discord chat.
Okay. Like
this section.
Overcome an obstacle, create or unlock an advantage, attack someone, or defend yourself.
Okay, sweet.
Boom.
So, right, yeah, basically, just to recap, Goose's character kind of just like raged out a little bit and tried to just... It was not all about being restrained. And then create a loud commotion, and then Joe's character is basically like panicking as well and trying to just turn into a puff of smoke.
Yeah, startled. I wouldn't say panicking.
But it's like you're kind of like, what the fuck's going on? I mean, it's like, shit, do this. Yeah.
Just might as well try that swing.
Get out. Yeah, so Joe, I would say that what you did is you did a sneaky approach. You tried to like slip out of your things and you turn into smoke, or like turn your wrist into smoke or something to like let you pull them through. And so basically you use a sneaky approach. So you get to roll 3 for your baseline sneaky, plus 2 because you used a fate point, so you have plus 5, and then you get to roll.
And I roll all 4 dice at the same time?
Yes.
6s? All 6.
Yep, you roll
D6.
Whoa, I'm doing it on the computer. I don't have real dice.
Okay.
And I got 2 5s and 2 2s.
So your 5s are plus 1s, your 2s are minus 1s, so you ended up with a total of... plus 0. So you end up with 5 to pass, so you're able to escape from your restraints with that way. You're able to like turn yourself into smoke and like slip through and get out of the restraint. So now you're free in the room. You still have the goggles on your head, but you can just take those off. I assume you do that pretty much immediately.
Yeah, 100%.
And you see yourself in a room. It's lit with a fluorescent bulb. There are some shelves with nothing on them, and it's very cold in there. It's kind of like got a silvery, fairly thick-looking door with a small glass window with metal... like metal threads bars. Going through to keep you from like shattering. Not bars, but if you've ever seen like reinforced glass with like metal twisted stuff through it. Yeah, like the time they have it like school and shit.
Okay, so then they also assumedly see the rest of us that are like still restrained.
No, you're all you appear to be in a room by yourself. So like the VR thing had you in like you could see each other in the VR environment, but now that you're in your like your own room, you're sort of like waking up from the Matrix in a way. You're like, what the fuck? Like huh.
Oh shit.
Okay, so Brendicus, what are you gonna be doing? Sorry, Mark Zombie.
Can I hear Brendicus works? Can I hear anything? Like any of that smashing stuff?
What Joe Zombie did was completely silent, but you do hear the clatter of this like metal chair clashing to the floor with the weight of a snake lizard man attached to it. So you know, it's not nothing. Like you almost feel it more than you hear it in a way, though. But like you definitely
like kind of quake, kind of like quake, and like, what the fuck?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, okay. So I think I.
It kind of sounds obviously, like a horror movie or something. It's like, what the fuck is going on?
Yeah, it sounds like Saw.
Yeah.
Hostile. I think I'm just gonna. I think. What am I seeing in the VR? Because I heard something in the real. You know, I guess I'm pretty disoriented because I could. I'm seeing obviously like I know something's in my face, or maybe I'm kind of aware that something's not right, but
so the VR. Things seem to have glitched out. So like you're not seeing anything. You're just like you just see like blank. Like it's a screen that's like dead. Like you can kind of like it's like when your TV's like not tuned to anything. You know, like it's okay. Black. Like you can kind of see it's glowing. And then like you try to move your arms, and you can feel that you're pretty tightly like bound to a chair.
Okay, I think I'm just gonna like shout and basically like I'm startled. So like you know. Disoriented and I hear all this you know commotion, so I'm just shouting for some help.
Okay.
You know, I don't like being alone, so I'm kind of like freaking out.
Roll for help.
Like shouting like who's there? What? Where am I? Who is there? What is that noise? Is that I smell smoke?
Oh man. All right.
So I'm not doing anything. I'm not necessarily like doing anything drastic other than just, you know, shouting for help and also like.
Okay. Yeah. So,
So if that's just like inaction, then that's fine. We can just progress and I'll be.
We can just progress. So, yeah. Joe and, sorry, let's see. Joe is your name and both character name.
Yeah, it's easy, don't worry.
J03.
Yeah, is that his real name?
Yeah. So Joe3 and Zakral, you're both in your rooms basically. So like, how do you think you're gonna like? What are you gonna do? Are you gonna like try the door? Or are you gonna like try and smash the window?
I want to just like kind of like what do I see in the like this kind of like area, this room? How does it look
okay,
like?
Okay, so the room you're in, it's all like shiny metal shelves. Like I don't know if you've ever been to like a research lab of any type, but I'm basically thinking like the walk-in refrigerators and freezers that I used to see. In
okay,
there.
Okay, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's very like featureless. There's just like stainless steel shelving and maybe sterile. Some like lab equipment and stuff in there. And there's like a little vent with like the refrigerated air coming in at the top. And then there's this like small window you can see in there. And there's a fairly heavy door. You don't know whether it's locked or not because you haven't tried it.
Okay. And it looks like it's a thick door.
But yes, it does look like it's a thick door. I mean, it's like insulated. It's not necessarily like, you know, supposed to like protect against like a sustained assault, but you know.
And you said there was a glass window or something?
Yeah, there's a small glass window with like wires going through it to like keep it reinforced or keep it from like shattering necessarily.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't be like, you know, trivial to break, but it would be
can
fairly
look,
easy.
Can I look through the window? Like, is it passable to look through the window?
Yeah, sure. So you put your face up to the window, and what you see out in the hallway is...
Okay.
I'll sketch this. You basically see what look like three doors on this back hall. Like, so opposite you guys, you see like three doors that look like it's standard like wooden doors, like they go to an office of some type.
Okay.
And then you can see... the light of what looks like a guard, but all the lights are off in the main warehouse area. The lights are on inside your refrigerated zone. I don't know if they just like know how to turn them off or what.
So you can't
see a whole lot of detail because the lights are off, but you can see that there's like three office doors on the other side and like a guard flashlight walking around.
There was a guard with a flashlight. Okay, and the guard looks like he's armed. If I can, it's like, can I see figuratively that he has like some kind of weapon on him, his arm?
No, the arm doesn't appear to be guard. The guard doesn't appear to be armed in any way that you can notice. He does. He has like a mask on, so you can't really see his like facial features at all. And he does seem to be like a fairly like hefty looking dude.
Okay.
Hmm.
And I'm just thinking, like, okay.
And I'm also I don't know if he can hear me, but I'm also just shouting like, help, where am I?
Yeah, can I do this? Do I hear Mark's character?
Let me out of here.
You basically hear like, you can tell there's like somebody kind of like freaking out.
Okay.
Next. So you appear to be in the thing that's closest to like the corner. You can't necessarily tell this, but like from looking at the wall, you can kind of see like it doesn't look like there's room for another refrigerating unit to like your side. Yeah. But there is, like you hear the sounds of Mark. Like Mark's probably in the middle and Joe's in the one that's like furthest down if you're in row three.
And a door has a handle, or is it just like, you know, those like shutter doors basically?
It has a handle. Because, you know, obviously like you're not gonna like get yourself locked in there and be like, oh shit, you know, like
yeah. I will, of course, always like try to use the doorknob, like the door is like to see is it locked or not.
Okay, so when you try to open the door, it does seem to like open at first, like it's not locked necessarily. They don't have ways to like lock people into these refrigerating things for obvious reasons. They're not like murder cabinets.
Okay.
But it does seem like they have something on the outside that's preventing it from like getting pushed out any further. So like you're able to engage the emergency lock to like unopen it, but then it's like there's something in the way. And when you open it and you start pushing on that thing, the guard sort of like turns his flashlight towards you and starts like heading your way. And he's like, hey, what's going on here?
All right. All right. I would kind of like, is there a...
Guard's coming at you, Goose.
The guards come at me. I know. I know what to do. Attack? I know what to do. So the share I'm using, or the share that was there. I was sitting in a share. Was the share like movable, or is it like fixed to the ground?
Yeah, I mean, it fell on the ground. That's what made all the noise. So it's just like a loose chair.
Come to the chair.
No, okay. I will place. I will take the share. And I will, let's see here. I'm just trying to imagine this. So, placing the chair in front of the door, a little bit ways off the door. I want like the back end of it, like the back end of the, facing the opposite of the wall, basically, not towards the door, but like the wall behind basically.
So, like, what exactly are you doing with the chair? I'm sorry.
So, what I'm trying to do is that once the guard opens the door, I'm going to I'm just going to fucking kick the chair right in front of him. So, he would have, like, a chair, like, flying at him, basically. Like, poof.
So, what I would say...
I'm like, help, I need to use the bathroom. Someone let me out. I have to go.
Ah, fuck that.
The advantage on an aspect that you already know about, I would say, is the action that has to do with... like setting up that chair basically, because it's like you know about the chair, obviously, so that's an aspect of the scene that you already know about. Yeah. And now you're trying to create an advantage using it, so you get to roll and I'm gonna say it's your plan's pretty solid, so I'm gonna give it +3 difficulty.
Okay,
because it is just a chair, it's not like it's a weapon necessarily, but like if you time it right and you get it like right when the door
is open,
I'm not
exactly, because I don't want to use it as a weapon. I'm gonna use it as a, you know, like a distraction. I'm throwing it, like kicking it at him, so he gets like a distraction from it, like you get hit by it, and now I was gonna go at him, he's like punch it basically.
Okay,
so that he
wants.
What's
your approach for that? Is that like probably, I mean, that kind of seems like it's a clever approach. I mean,
okay.
I don't know, like, if that's something good for you, but...
I don't know. I think I have, like, what do I have? Let's see here. Where's my character sheet again? I have one in clever.
So I guess you could, you know, like, that could be kind
of... Is that a flashy?
Like,
I thought it was a flashy, because I'm kicking it.
I'd say that could be quick. I'll give that quick. So start
+2.
Yeah.
I think quick makes the most sense, because, like, you startle the guard. The guard's coming at him, so you have to act quick.
Yeah, basically. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because I'm thinking that, it's like kicking the chair, that it gets like the chair on it, and then like my follow up is like going out and punch it, basically. That's how I will do it. Well, that's how Sekral will do it.
Sekral.
I ain't taking this bullshit.
Okay, so let's roll that at +3. So what's your roll?
Okay, so I'm gonna roll my dice here. Four dices.
Always four.
Always four.
Always four. Yep, always four. Okay. Ooh, okay. So I have one minus and I have one blank, but I have two successes.
So, okay, so that gives you a total of plus one.
Plus one of this.
And
this...
your baseline was plus two, so that gives you a plus three. You need to succeed. So there you go. Zah. You successfully set up this thing, so now you have a free invocation of that aspect. So that basically lets you use it as like a boost of some kind on a roll that would use it.
Do you mean boost as in like if I would ever to do something like that again, I get a boost from that? Or how does it work with aspects?
You use it to modify, so you can decide whether to use it to modify your roll, basically. And like instead of having to use a fate counter on it, you just get like you spent an action to do that instead of using like a fate counter to do it. So, yeah. So now
he takes a note of and saves it for later, or
yeah. So he has the aspect of like he has a free invocation of the chair aspect that he can use now. He's okay. Got it like set up to be able to use basically. Okay. So like as long as he's still in that room, he has that chair set up in a way that he can like easily shove it at the door or whatever. Yeah. So based on what he decides to do. When he's using that, like if he's like, you know, overcome an obstacle where he's like, I just want to shove it at the guard and like run past him or something, you know, that would be like one way.
I think that's pretty much what you decided you're doing, right?
Yeah.
So I can say that now I need to switch over to Joe or Mark and have them decide what they're doing during this time. So like you're hearing some clattering stuff going on nearby, but you know, it's kind of all muted and not clear. So Joe, what are you up to?
Is he a smoke cloud right now?
No, he just, I'm going to say that, like, he doesn't, like, transform into a smoke cloud. That's pretty, like, potent of an ability to, like, give you something that's, like, you know, consistent like that. But basically, at any time, he can, like, use a fate counter to invoke that aspect to do something special, basically. Be like, oh, well, I turn into smoke and then do this thing. But it's not like, oh, he's smoke form now. He's going to be smoke form, he's not smoke form anymore. Right. He gets to use it for advantage on everything, you know. That's just not how this game.
What was the recap of what did Joe do at first then?
So he basically like he felt himself like strapped into chairs and he basically like turned his like arms and body into like smoke and like slipped out of these restraints and took off his goggles. Right.
J03. You're muted.
Appreciate that. Welcome back. Definitely trying to check out the room some more. Definitely hastily, just seeing if there's anything I could use of any items besides the chair, or if there's just any other openings besides, well, the window. I guess it's not really an opening, but anything of that nature.
So one difference between Fate and D&D, as far as I understand it, is that in Fate, it's a little bit more player-driven in that, unlike in D&D where it's like, hey, tell me what's in the room, and it's up to you. You actually have the option of, they call it creating an aspect. It's one of the options that you take. In that case, you basically get to say, like, I want there to be this thing that exists. And then it's up to me as a DM to make it make sense that it exists. You know, it's like, it can't be, like, incongruous with, like, what I already have. Like, it can't be, like, oh, there's a horse in the room with me. Like, there has to be some way that could exist.
You'd be like I grabbed the carpet and rip it up.
If I said, oh, you see this, you'd have a response to it. Instead, you just say, I look for this thing. I try to discover this thing. And then creating the aspect is whether or not that thing actually exists, basically. Like, you roll to see whether or not you successfully find, you know, like a crowbar or whatever it is that you might be looking for.
Or it's like, I look for the control panel to turn off the cooling system or something. Because you said these rooms are cooled, right?
Yeah.
Like it's a refrigerator? Okay.
Chill. Yeah. Basically, yeah.
So you could just be like, oh, well, I'm going to try to find. Yeah. But, anyways, Joe.
Yeah.
J03.
I feel like a scumbag if I use another power, huh?
It's up to you. That's totally up to you.
Tokens,
totally up to you. It's your choice.
Because I also have a short teleport. But I guess.
Well, so the. The guard is going towards Goose's door, right?
He doesn't know that yet.
The crop, okay.
Unless he watches.
I'm thinking about like the window's see-through, obviously. It just has like the mini micro bars you're saying. Be reinforced. So I run up to the window, check to see what's going on, because obviously the ruckus. See the flashlight, the other doors. And I see the guard heading towards Goose's door.
It's a crawl.
Yeah. It's a crawl's door, my bad.
Oh, we don't.
Yeah. But you don't know it yet.
We don't know. Yeah, someone's door. We don't know that. Yeah.
Yes, someone. Yeah, exactly. What will you do? You gonna hack the door?
I think I might do a. I should probably just check the door because my character doesn't know shit. So I'm also gonna check the door, and see is like.
Ah, shit.
And try to kick it open. Fuck it. I'm just gonna try. Like,
yeah, so like you're able to do the same thing. Like you sort of like push on the door, and it like goes for it a little bit, and then like chunks shut. Like it seems like it's like chained or somehow like blocked off. Mm. So it's like. They have some kind of thing like fused on the outside that like prevents it from like opening entirely, but they're not able to like use the actual like lock because there's emergency escapes on these things.
I'm just gonna short teleport out and fucking.
Okay, so you're gonna use a fake
guard in the back. Yeah.
Okay. So the other option is that you can use your action to I think this is how you can use aspects as well, is you can use your action to create an advantage on an aspect that you already know about. But the downside of that is if you fail, it means that I, as the GM, get to use that aspect against you in some way. So it's a little bit riskier. It's like using a fate point is just like, I'm doing this cool thing. I'm making this cool thing happen. It's a guaranteed, like, not guaranteed success, but it's a guaranteed, like, benefit to my actions. Rolling to invoke an action that already exists has so if you try to create an advantage on an aspect you already know about, if you fail you get no additional benefit, so I guess that's not so bad. If you tie, you get one free invocation on the subject. If you succeed, you get one free invocation. So tie or success is the same if it's something you already know about. Succeeding with style gives you two free invocations on the aspect, so you can basically like have nothing happen and basically like waste your turn or whatever. Or you can potentially get a free invocation on it. That seems kind of powerful, but I don't know how else you're supposed to like use your like aspects and stuff. So if anyone in the chat has played Fate before and knows how to like resolve this, that'd be fantastic if they could chime in. But if not, I'll just have to do some reading between.
So he can do teleport and do another action.
I think, Joe basically sees the guard going for the door, so he wants to charge out and judo chop him.
Yeah, exactly.
So whether he teleports out or not, or whether he kicks the door, I mean, he probably doesn't want to kick the door open. I don't know.
Yeah, so I mean, that's kind of like two or three actions. Like, he can use his fate point to invoke his aspect and immediately use that invoked aspect to increase his chances of doing the overcome, which would be how he would escape from there. He would like slip through, which obviously without his smoke form would be very difficult to do, but with it is feasible to do. Then the other option would be he could use one action to create that advantage to like go into smoke form. Then the next time he gets an action, he would use the overcome action and invoke that aspect that he created an advantage on the last time. Sort of like Goose spent an action to set up his chair instead of like using a fate point to like use the chair in response or like whatever. And then attacking would be another action. So like it's not like you get to do like all these things all at once. It'd be like three actions to get out and attack the guy. So it kind of depends on like how quick you want to be with it, I think. And I'm not keeping like super close track of like who gets how many turns right now. I think at some point I'm gonna have to be a little bit more specific about that, like as soon as you're in like actual like combat and stuff.
When we are in combat, you can just like roll a d6 or whatever, see whoever gets in position wise. Or d20.
I think I'm still gonna do like the short teleport.
Mm-hmm.
But behind the guard.
Okay, so you're using your invocation spell, or like you're invoking a fate point to use your teleport thing.
Yeah, frick it.
Okay. So you just use your fate point. You're now down to one fate point, I believe. I mean, it's, you go back up to three at the beginning of your next session. So like, yeah. You do want to be using them. You don't want to like sit on them. They don't like stack up or anything.
I want to stack them up. I want to fuck shit up.
Okay, and so you teleport out into the hallway, kind of like behind the guard that is currently opening, that is about to be opening Goose's, what is your name?
Zekral
is about to be like opening your door. So like, you can see him like pulling out the like thick pin that's like keeping like the chain. And now it is probably Mark's turn to do something.
I mean, I'm not really, okay, well, I guess since no one's coming to help me.
help me, save me.
No one's, my voice, so I'm going to see if I can, my hands are bound, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I want to just see if I can, like, maybe hop my chair, or, like, wiggle over to, like, the door. try to pull the braces off onto the doorknob. Just try to like, I'm hopping towards the door in my chair, wiggling towards the door, or a wall, and trying to smash these bracers. Like,
so I'd say that approach seems to be careful, unless you want to try to come up with something else as a way of like doing that. It seems like you're sort of carefully being like, whoop, 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 like walking over to like the wall.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. So, so all you're trying to do right now is just like move over to something. And what are you trying to accomplish with that?
I'm trying to get my hands. I'm trying to gain control of my hands again. And yeah, like get, so I guess I can't see anything, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I'm just hobbling. Yeah, hobbling towards like whichever direction, like looking for a wall, trying to see how big the room I'm in is, and trying to like find something I can like bash my hands against, or like a way to break these bindings.
Okay, so again, I think what you want to do is you want to try to come up with like, what is something that if you were to find it would be helpful for you?
The door. I'm hobbling towards the door. No one's coming to save me, so I'm like, I'm going towards the noise. I'm going towards the door. And, yeah. I'm looking for the door, even though I'm bound.
Oh, yeah. You still have the VR headset on you, so you don't
actually, I still have it, yeah.
You don't actually see physically. Oh, yeah.
I'm basically like, oh, fam, no one's coming to help me. I gotta do it myself. And
oh, God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, God.
Bouncing towards the door. Did we lose Steve?
No, sorry. I'm reading.
Okay. No, no problem.
Oh, God, Steve, no!
Your camera was glitching out. I wasn't sure if I was.
He's dead. Steve's dead.
So okay. I'm trying to figure out whether you're trying to create an advantage and discovering a new aspect, or whether you're trying to just, like, overcome an obstacle right now.
I think overcome an obstacle sounds more in line.
Okay. So why don't you do that?
Okay.
So it's going to be, I was going to put the same difficulty as everyone else, just +4. Actually, I guess you're not trying to escape necessarily immediately. You're just trying to like get out like a little bit. So I'm going to get that +2. Like, you're just trying to move a chair. You're not trying to like break bindings. That's a little bit easier.
Yeah. I'm trying to move my like hop, wiggle my chair, or like go towards the noise to try to find someone.
Hmm.
Hmm.
So I roll?
Yep.
Okay, so what is it? 4 and 5 are neutral?
Two and three are negative.
5 and 6 are positive. 3 and 4 are neutral.
Okay, so I actually have two positive, two neutral.
Okay, so
and then I'm doing careful. Is that careful?
Uh-huh.
Is +1.
Okay, so you got +3, which is enough to beat the +2. I don't think it succeeds with style, though. I need to look up what threshold for that is.
Hmm.
Okay, that's higher by 3 or more. Oh, and success is higher by one or two, so a tie is actually equal. Like, so whatever, we'll figure that out. That makes sense. Fail is lower, tie is equal, success is higher. So you got one or two higher, so you just got a normal success on that. So you're able to reach the door and able to kind of like prop your chair out against it. And you can feel like a little bit, like you can feel the door like move just a little bit, just enough to like break the seal. And like you can kind of feel
are,
like
are my hands like are my hands how are my hands bound? Are they behind me in the chair?
They're behind you, bound to the chair itself. So it's okay. Like each hand is individually bound to like the frame of the chair.
So I'm my back is against the door, is what you said?
Yep, you sort of be able to like rock around and like eventually like tip your chair back and get it to like push up against the door.
Okay. So I guess do I keep going? Or I mean no?
I'm kind of trying to have, like, I think at this point, everyone's sort of, like, in the same environment as much as you're going to be, you know?
Okay.
So
I basically hobbled my way towards the door where the noise is coming on. I'm, like, kind of, like, jingling with the handle, and then it goes back to probably Sakral.
Well, actually, mm-hmm. We're just going to go with turn order, because we're now going with physical conflict. Because we're about to have a door open and have like a chair go off and stuff. So we're gonna figure out what we're gonna come out with this. So that's gonna be comparing quick approaches.
Quick. Let's see here. Notes. I have two in quick.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what's
The rest of us?
Yeah, everyone is.
My quick is two.
Two also.
You guys, that's like, did you even look at these other character sheets when you're rolling characters?
No.
Did that copycat me? What the fuck?
What the fuck? All right.
I should go first because my character's more elaborate.
Okay, so you guys always get to decide what order you go in. So fantastic. Figure out what order you go in. And then you guys all get to go before the bad guy goes, because he's just a mook.
Well, it's probably
Goose, myself, then Mark, right?
Yeah, that's what I would think. That'd
be the order right now.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll have the mook finish their one action, which is going to be they're going to lift off the bolt that's keeping the chain from Zakral's door shut, basically, to like check in on what's happening there.
He's not fully open. He just,
then
like,
it's going to be whatever order you guys want to go in.
Yeah. Okay. He has not fully opened it yet. He's just like kind of like starting to open, like kind of removing bolts.
He has it unlatched, so like at any point he could grab the door and pull on it, or you could push on the door and have it like blast open, but it's not locked anymore. So like you can hear this like heavy like shink, like as he like pulls out a bolt from something.
Basically. I'd still say Goose myself then, Mark. Okay. Goose first, no matter what.
Yeah.
Myself.
That's fine. That's fine. That's fine.
Already out there.
Yeah. Right. Shit.
Mark's chilling.
Yeah. And there's no way to, like, say, like, in D&D, you can hold an action, like, say, once he does open a door, then my action comes in play. That doesn't work
here. I don't think so.
So should we have... Okay. Yeah, because Goose basically wants him to open the door and then to do it. we could have myself or Joe go in that case, then. Or...
I mean, you could basically, like... Whatever it is you're planning on doing, you can have opening the door be part of that action. Like when he opens the door, were you going to attack him with the chair? Were you going to like shove him with the
chair?
Kick
the chair at him, yeah.
Open the door and do that.
I'll try to use the chair to kind of like kick the chair at him, so he's like distracted, like kind of like how you say it? He's
diversion,
like,
almost.
Diversion, stumbling, kind of like oh, what the fuck? Like poof, get the chair on him, basically, and then moving in to hit him like a follow up. That was my plan, at least, to do that. But I guess, like, if we can't do that, then I'm guessing that I will... Do I know or feel like that he has unlocked the door, or is, like, in the process?
Yes. Yeah, you heard him. You heard that chain, like get dropped, and, like, it seems like it's...
Yeah. Well, I guess then I will use the chair to kind of, like, bull rush the door.
Okay, so you're trying to like attack this guy, like cause physical harm to them, or are you just trying to like push them out of the way, like
physical harm? I don't know him. I'm trapped in this like prison something. I don't know him. He's gotta be hostile. Okay. Someone's like, my reaction is like, Yeah, my reaction is just like, fuck this shit. Like,
do we have our weapons?
I presume not.
Probably not, yeah.
I presume not.
That's what I assume, but no one asked. That's what I assume, but no one asked.
True.
Yeah, you don't have your weapons with you or in the room with you that you can see. Let me look real quick how combat works.
Yeah. Because if I can't hold an action, like, because that's the what I tried to do. Sorry, I was didn't explain properly at the beginning. But then, yeah, then I will just, like, fucking bull rush with the shear, like, poof, at him.
Okay, perfect. So,
and then punch him.
So we're going to roll against each other with this.
Oh, okay.
Oh, shit.
So you are fighting right now a null set thug is what they're called. So you don't know what that means, but he has a mask on that like completely like obscures any like facial expressions. Like it just is like a pure like white mask.
Null set? You said null set?
Yes.
N-U-L-L-S-E-T.
Yep.
Null set.
And there are aspects that you can use if you want, or that, you know, the aspects that are related to them, which I think are things that everyone's supposed to know, are that they're part of the null set, so you don't really know what that means so much now, and they're a coward under pressure.
Perfect. All right. Well, yeah, I'm just going to go ahead with the plan. Fuck a bull rush.
So you roll to attack, and you have plus two. Well, I guess you can invoke your aspects. I think that's maybe after you roll, you get a chance to choose what you want to use with that. Let me look this up real quick. Okay, so invoking the aspect is you can add plus two to your total, reroll the dice, confront an opponent with the aspect. So that would be like to make something harder for an opponent. So like if I said I was going to have this thug like attack you again, you'd be like, hey, this guy's supposed to be cowardly under pressure. I want to use my fate point to make it like more difficult for him to attack. I want to use my fate point to give myself plus two to defense or whatever.
Okay.
But you get to roll before you choose to use your aspect necessarily.
So right now I'm using my aspect of this shear basically. The sheer setup aspect.
Yeah, yeah. But you don't necessarily have to. You first get to see what the result of the roll is, then you get to decide whether you want to use that. But yeah. I mean, you can decide how you want to use it, like whether you use it to re-roll all the dice or add plus two. So it depends on whether you barely fail or fail by a lot.
Let's see here. I have one fail, two neutrals, one success.
So yeah, plus zero. And this was the thing you have plus three on, like you're good at doing like aggressive movements or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, perfect. So the enemy rolled plus one for their defense. So I think that subtracts one from the amount of damage that would take, so they can take two damage or something. I need to this real quick. All right, when you're hit by an attack, severity of the hit. Okay, I'll read this out loud. So when you're hit by an attack, the severity of the hit is difference between the attack roll and the defense roll. So you got plus three, or if you use your aspect, it'd be plus five to hit, and he got one defense. So, when you take damage, you either suffer stress or consequences or get knocked out.
And I should declare my like aspect before that happened, I presume?
No, once you know what the total is, you get to decide whether you want to add plus two to it or not.
Does it take my fate point in it?
No, because you used it to use your action to create an advantage last turn. So the success on that gives you a free invocation of that singular aspect.
Gotcha.
So kind of the equivalent of doing the like wait a turn in D&D is like instead of using an aspect immediately, you're like, well, I'm going to set up and use this more advantageously later.
Makes sense. Okay, I understand. Then I guess I will use that aspect to increase the success.
Okay, so basically, like, this guy is, like, gonna check on in here, thinking he's gonna find someone who, like, fell over and is, like, passed out and having a seizure or something in the chair, and instead finds a fully active, enraged lizard man with a chair in his hands who just, like, shucks at him and comes, like, flying out of the thing and just smashes him into a wall, and he just, like, falls over, slumps, and is just, like, completely out. You don't know whether he's dead or unconscious, but he is not fighting anymore.
Nice. Oh,
shit.
Yeah. Perfect.
All right, so now it's Joe's turn.
Thought that was going to turn out a little differently. Woo! Well, shit, I guess at this point, I'm out. Just saw that go down. I'm a little freaked out.
A little bit freaked out.
Not sure if Goose is good or bad at this point, or Zelt's car.
Whoever, you don't even know who's in that room. Wait, so what did J03 see exactly? Because he was out in the hall.
So he, like, teleported behind that guard, saw the guard open the thing, and then saw the door just, like, fly open, a chair just, like, smashing the guy, and the guy, like, flies past him into, like, the wall behind Joe, basically. And Joe's just like, I don't know how you react, but however he reacts.
Yeah, that was my reaction.
So much. Okay.
So I guess you guys basically, like, resolve that quick combat situation, so you can kind of be a little more freeform in terms of your actions, but, you know, however you want to do things.
Very cautiously approach Goose, or sorry, I need to use names. Very cautiously approach
the door. You don't know he's in there at this point.
Yeah.
Yeah, he does, because he busted out and
you can see a lizard man in there.
A huge lizard man.
Okay, so you approach the lizard man.
Try to communicate. Not even approach. Try to communicate. Or,
so this is the part where I kind of step back and you guys just talk to each other in character. So, have fun.
Yeah.
Who are you? What the? Do you have any answers and do you understand me? What is your name? And what are you?
You would have seen this guy before one time when you were all entering into this place. So, like, you have some inclination that you're on the same side.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, you've seen me before, basically. Yeah. So it's like, so Joe's character is outside with me right now. He has also opened, like, the hatch, whatever.
Yeah, you two are, like, kind of, like, conversing or sharing, like, talking about what's happened. Yeah. Like, where are we? Like,
what's your name first? I'm Joe, J-O-3.
I mean, it's like,
damn pleased to meet you.
I mean, it's like, kind of like, it's like looking at Joe, like, well,
okay.
My name is Zikral. It's a pleasure to meet you as well.
Meanwhile, in the distance, they kind of see, or they hear the fumblings of one door. Like help! Help! Someone, I'm still tied up in the room. My hands behind my back. I'm like trying to, like, jingle the door. And I'm kind of screaming, so they hear muffled screams as well. Someone, it's really cold. I have to use the bathroom. Help me, someone. And I'm jingling with the door.
I'm just, like, going to approach the door, basically, and, like, fucking kick the door open.
We should start letting everybody out.
Yeah.
Because obviously everyone got the same invitations.
So you pull open the latch to Mark's door, and as soon as you do so, the fact he's leaning against it with a chair means that slides open. And now I'll let you guys resume the scene.
Who are you? I'll hurt you. Just don't untie me. Help.
Just calm down for now.
None of us know have any idea what's going on. Calm down. What's your name? Let's start.
I'm just leaning it up towards.
Brendicus, now untie me now.
I'm Joe, and this is a crawl. We're untying you. Calm down. Get the VR headset off you also. You can see our faces.
Oh. Yeah, I'm untying his hands, and Joe is taking off his spear.
Owl boy, or that hawk dude that
sent us a letter. He invited us all.
We don't know what happened here.
We need to get the others out. We're not the only ones here. We got Arachno boy. We got Hawk guy. And then whoever the fuck the other person was that was with us.
Sugar glider, I think.
Sugar glider, yep.
I've only heard rumors of Zakral.
Did you guys remember at all what happened before this all got poison gas?
I remember getting the invitation, which came to me randomly on the street from a homeless man. So I don't even know how he contacted me or knew who I was or knew where to even find me. How about you guys? This is all weird.
I was getting my signature drink, a venti double shot espresso with milk there, and he passed me my cup, and then there was also the invitation in the hand. The barista. He must be with them. Zakral? Is that how I say it? Zakral?
Yes, it's Zakral. That's correct.
What about you? Who brought you here? Where was your invitation from?
I got my invitation. Well, I got invitation from one of my contacts, seeing they need some joining forces here. It was supposed to be for him, but he passed it on to me instead. Before he himself passed on.
Okay, well, I suppose we should... do we see any other... We see other rooms?
So, the environment you guys are in is a... it's like a warehouse type thing. So it's got high ceilings and a slick floor and just like loads of like different types of equipment, like freezers and just stuff out in the hallway. It looks like it's kind of like disused, maybe it's like biological supplies or something.
Yeah.
And you see across from you, like on the far side of the hallway. So you're basically in like a hallway that like dead ends against Joe's cell. So let's see. You can see right now, basically, it's terrible, that won't work. you've got your Shit. Three rooms that you're in. Then there's like a dead end hallway to your right, and to the left it looks like there's like another hallway that like leads into there. And across from you guys, like across the entire back end of the warehouse, there appear to be three office doors.
Well, I think we should probably try to find at least the sugar glider and maybe the hawk dude. And if we could find a bathroom as well. I quite need to go. It's so cold in here. I can't hold it much longer.
You need to go to the bathroom?
Yes. You have those where you're from there, lizard boy?
We consume our own. So you don't need to worry. It's all being recycled. So we can keep on fighting.
Well, who wants to go first? I'm certainly not going to be leading the way here.
I can take the lead here. I can take the lead. It's no problem.
Okay, so you guys are going to be like going around the corner and like going into the other hallway that seems to be leading to like the rest of the
office doors.
Well, so there's the office doors that are like across from you guys, and basically like your options would be like go across the hall and like fuck around those office doors, or take a left and go like down the hallway where it seems like there's like another. So there's like a hallway that goes like all the way from like the front to the back of the warehouse, you'd assume, and it sort of like branches off to the right, and you're in like the furthest off branch. It's kind of shaped like a capital E, like the hallway.
Okay.
Like the offices along like one end of like either the top or bottom of it, and then the like indented parts of the E's are where the like refrigerator.
I want to check the pulse on the null set mercenary or the thug, see if he's alive still.
I mean, that's up to you guys. Would you have wanted to kill him or not? Like, I don't care. Like,
I don't, because I want to question this motherfucker.
Question him and then break his neck.
Is that possible? Or should I just not? Like,
I mean, so he's alive, but very unconscious. Like, he cracked his head really hard against that wall and does not seem like he'll be waking up anytime soon.
Well, we should at least...
You have to carry this guy. And we have to wait until he wakes up.
Carry him? I'm not going to carry him.
Well,
what do you say?
drag his body into a room there, just so he's not in the middle of the hallway. Maybe cover up our trace a little bit.
Yes. Looks like there's nobody has escaped.
Not a bad idea.
What is he wearing? we know he has a mask, right?
Yeah, he's got this like null white mask, and then he's just wearing like a gray, just like leotard onesie, basically. Like he's no pockets.
God damn it. All right. No money. Shit. Also, I think it's a good moment here to kind of describe how our characters look like.
Oh, okay.
That, I was just saying for like everybody who's watching here. So, my character, Zekral, big, hulking, like crocodile-esque humanoid creature with black and turquoise scales. And he has also, haven't added this, but he has also some jewelries to him, like some gold and jewelries on his scales, part of his like spiky scales and stuff like that on his body. And his overall structure is just is quite large and quite big, and you can clearly see that they're there's like more pronounced like scales that is coming out of my own body, basically. Since it is like an extra layer of like armor to my own character in a way. And there's like orange, bright orange, like cat eyes, basically. And like a long snout as well. Kind of like a crocodile.
Yeah, so I guess I'll go next and Brendicus there. I've got long black hair, but I usually put it up in a nice little man bun there so it doesn't get in my way. And I'm tall and scrawny, glasses, mustache, and goatee, well-dressed. I have my signature robe, which robe plus vest combination, and on the robe there is a golden giraffe that I've kind of gotten affixed onto there, and it's the robe is actually from my parents, and it has their like company logo because they're almost like kind of like an Amazon or a Google, like a massive corporation, and their logo is a big tree, which we still need a name for this, but and then I have a stitched on there as a giraffe taking a bite out of the tree.
I got semi long black hair, a long hoodie with black jeans and red Converse, pretty casual looking, try to blend in as much as possible while in like the city and shit.
Yeah,
so nothing crazy, nothing standoutish, just an average Joe.
Just an average Joe.
Well, it's the crowd of those. I couldn't help but notice those scales. They're quite pretty and shiny there.
Oh, well. Thank you so much. We have different kinds of colorations to own scales, but it all comes down more to where your lineage is from.
Actually, but I don't mean to interrupt. All you guys, I think,
are kind of like responding a little bit to like the shock you're in of just like you're just like having like a very normal seeming conversation. And you hear in the distance what appears to be the sounds of muffled conversation between what could be guards or could be perhaps other
heroes. Not to interrupt you, boys, but we got people in the distance. We have
drag that body into one of the rooms here quickly, then.
I just like quickly, it's like dragging the body, like toss him in like a room. Like, fuck it.
And I want to grab one of those VR masks things and to bring it with me and just kind of put it in my pockets just to observe the technology later.
Okay, perfect. It seems like it's a wireless unit, so it's just like strapped to your head with like, you know, some like straps, but other than that was, you know, like you take it off.
Okay,
it
doesn't
have any like wires or anything going to it.
All right, so who's going to lead the way? What do? We go towards the voices, away from the voices?
Okay, so where, like, from the muffling noises, are they coming from left or right or through the offices?
Like, so they're not coming in the direction. Office, they're coming from like the hallway that's to your left.
To our left. Right,
just leads to like a wall. Like there's nothing really interesting there. There's just like, you know, your three cells and then like a wall, and then there's the three offices on the other side of that hallway. It's kind of like a dead end there, but you can see that it goes off like back.
Okay. I would go against the wall to our left and kind of lean. Well, actually, no.
J03, is that you, your name? Or is this Joe? Okay.
Just joking.
So we're having some approaches problems coming at us. Why don't you go to the left there, sneak from the corner, see what you can see.
Exactly what I was thinking.
Yes, going and for look for the bathroom there. I need to go.
Brenda Kiss, go with them.
You can hold a little bit longer. Hush.
Okay, sorry.
Sneaking, file cabinet. Down the dark, long dark hallway. So the warehouse was like dark, right?
Yeah, the warehouse is dark and there's a lot of like equipment and stuff. So you can kind of like stealthily like make your way up and peek down the hallway from like around like, you know, like a empty, you know, container of some kind of like pressurized gas or something perhaps. You know, just some like medical equipment of some type. So you're like looking around the corner and you see two flashlights, sort of like their light, you know, shining down. And you can see that there's two people walking down. They appear to be, you know, null set thugs of the same type. Like they don't have any like visible like facial features or like anything like distinct about their uniform or anything.
They're already running or walking?
To listen to the conversation.
They're walking and you can kind of hear that like they're
Is that an action?
They kind of seem like they sort of have muffled voices because they've got these masks on. So
yeah,
you can't,
yeah.
Like, they make it out, but kind of seems like they're sort of like.
You're the fucking best man. Okay, so they seem to be alerted to our presence at least.
Yeah, like they're definitely like. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Gotcha.
This might be a perfect opportunity to show you guys my powers.
Why don't you go into position then? See what you got.
Okay, so I guess I'm gonna creep up next to J03 there and kind of peek over his shoulder, and then start channeling my mind control abilities here, if that's possible.
Fate token.
So, again, like it's not. In the fate system, it's less about, like, I'm going to use this power which does these specific things. It's more about, I want to accomplish this thing, and this is how I'm going to use my power to accomplish this thing. So,
okay.
Like,
I want to extract information. I want to assume, I want to take control of one of these guards and basically kind of just do some small talk and try to get some details, basically. I don't know. Should I just assume that that's already happening and go on with the conversation or
no, like I'm definitely taking an action of some type, so I don't know, like
I guess I want to create create an advantage.
Yeah, I guess that would make sense. You're like, you're creating an advantage, which would be like, you know, a mind control. Like you're temporarily creating an advantage of making like a mind controlled thing. You know, like you're trying to make this guard into like a mind controlled guard or whatever. So, I think.
Yeah, and I'm basically if it helps, I'm like, if I am able to do this, I kind of want to be like, yeah. So I'm pretty excited for, you know, the boss's plans. How about you?
So,
it's a bathroom math. I don't know.
So are you using a fate counter to invoke this, or are you? Yeah. By the way, where's the bathroom?
Yeah. I am.
You said it was the boss's plans. Why take a piss together?
Token. Use a token. Is that what you're saying?
I'm trying to think about what would be. It's kind of like outside of the thing. Hang on, just one second.
Yeah, I was wondering about if my power is gonna like break the game or make it really hard for you.
Yeah, this is like interesting how like abilities works. Like how.
Yeah, and also we can take a moment to catch up with chat here.
I'm trying to be interactive here, but yeah.
Yes, we have Ivy Play Games. Welcome, and
welcome. Thank you once again, also, Dark Echo, for the raid. Thank you
so
much.
Dark Echo with the raid. Greenfish is here hanging out. We are playing the Fate Accelerated Edition. This is our first kind of mission here. And I can link, I've been linking our character sheets and also the rule book.
Yep.
So I guess what you'd be doing here, Mark, is you'd be creating an advantage, which would be discovering an existing situation aspect. So I would say that without using a fate counter, it's, even though it's your power, it's still fairly difficult for
you. I want to use one. I want to use one.
Okay.
Fate token? Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah. Hang on. Yeah. Mm. Yeah, so use a fate token.
Okay.
Give yourself a boost on this because it's a fairly difficult power for you to use most of the time. I think you get to... I don't know whether you get to choose whether to use a fate counter before or after you see what your role is on stuff like this. I'll have to figure out some of like the
exact rules.
Let's say now you're going to use a fate counter on it, like definitely, because you want to invoke your power.
Yep.
So now you've invoked your aspect of being the mind taker. Like you invoked your high concept, basically, which is where your power comes from. And so now you get to use that boost on creating an advantage. So you're creating an advantage against this guy. So you're trying to basically take over his mind entirely and like talk as if you're him.
Yes.
So I'm going to say that that's pretty, like, pretty fucking hard. That's, I'm going to give that a +5.
Okay.
I don't know how hard that is, but I know that's pretty hard. +4 is supposed to be like difficult. So 5 is harder than that.
Got this. You got this, Mark. Super. Yeah. Find a bathroom. Find a fucking bathroom.
I'll show off my powers.
How do you go about invoking your power? Like, what do you do? Like, describe what it looks like, or like how you'd want to, like, what kind of like approach do you want to use for this?
J03 is peering around the corner, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I've kind of like boasted a little bit about, oh, let me show you guys my perfect opportunity to show off my amazing powers here. And I'm also like peeking over J03's shoulder a little bit too close. He can still smell the venti coffee on my breath. And I'm kind of muttering in nonsensical things and doing this with my fingers here. And any moment now it's going to go off here. And then I roll.
So what approach were you trying to go for?
I mean, I guess this is...
like, I would say probably clever.
Yeah, I was going to say clever or flashy, but I don't know if it's necessarily flashy.
That's flashy, I think, would be a little bit more like if you were doing it kind of like in a stage show type thing. Right. You're like, okay, so... and somebody's like, clever.
This is clever.
So we sort of like have like sparks come out of your hand and like, you know, like it would have to be something a little bit more like, you know, bombastic. Like,
yeah, and I'm doing that and muttering stuff, that you can see on the back of my robe, the golden giraffe is kind of like pulsing colors, like kind of pulsing gold.
I'd say, you know, if you're invoking that if you want flashy, you can do flashy. It seems like you're kind of trying to do that, so that's fair.
Yeah, and okay, yeah. So the gold, as I'm doing that with my fingers, you see the all of a sudden the giraffe like starts to like glow gold, and then also, previously there's no detail on the robe, but then there's like these kind of like you know, runes and stuff that like light a runic pattern on the robe that kind of comes out and starts lighting up as well with the giraffe.
The man bun just falls down, also wind blowing in the hair.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. I actually, before I do that, I kind of like take the man bun off, and then my hair is also kind of like going as well.
Canteen commercial style. I love it.
Oh god.
Okay.
Power level 1,000.
So that cheese.
Yep.
I have 3 5s and a 1. So I guess
3 5s are +3, 1 is -1, so you get +2, and your baseline is what, +3?
3, yeah.
Okay, so that's a tie. So on a tie.
Got this.
So you're trying to discover existing or create a new aspect. Okay, so since you tied, when you're trying to create a new aspect, you get a boost. So look up what a boost is real quick.
Okay.
A boost is a temporary aspect that you get to use once, then it vanishes. Unused boosts vanish when the scene they were created in is over or when the advantage they represent no longer exists. These represent very brief and fleeting advantages you get in conflicts with others. So, what you can do with an aspect, I think you'd want to do in this case, is you can establish facts with an aspect. So,
okay.
You basically get to
And also, as I am like kind of assuming control here, all of a sudden, like, I'm already leaning right next to G03, but I kind of like kind of fall. I'm now actually propped up on him. He's kind of like holding me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Joe's like, what the fuck?
I'm like leaning on him way too close to his side.
So I guess that basically what you get to do is you can invoke this aspect to, as like a boost, you basically get to like say, like you're able to like communicate as this guy for like one question and answer thing. Like you find yourself in this guy's mind for a moment and you have like a few seconds where you can like use your power basically.
Okay. I'm gonna say, hey, do you know where the bathroom is around here?
I knew it! Yes.
Okay, so the answer to that question is, according to the map I drew, there is no bathroom in this warehouse. There is an outhouse, a little porta potty outside in the front of the warehouse, but there's no actual internal bathrooms here.
Okay. And is that my only opportunity? Is that it?
I mean, yeah, that's what you did.
I kind of wake up and immediately drop.
The bathroom's out front.
I immediately drop Mark for effing over our only
chance. You guys can't hear what was said, right? They can't hear what I said to them.
You know what the bathroom is?
You're gonna lie to us.
Your eyes like roll back from like being in the back of your head, and you're like back with them, and you say,
"Well, I couldn't find anything about this villain here, and I don't think there's a bathroom anywhere that we'll have to worry about. But we should keep moving and get
Did
more
you
information on Equalizer.
Serious? Ask about the bathroom?
Equalizer. I don't think these thugs actually know his real plans. They're just peasants here, so we'll have to find someone with more information. But I did it in
okay.
control and
okay.
Roger yes. that. Thanks for doing that.
No problem.
All right, let's quickly
Pretty
check
cool.
one of these doors. We need to start checking stuff.
I like your giraffe. You had your new coat.
Brendicus couldn't get any information. We picked door number 3.
So you're doing the door that's like that's furthest into this like dead end, or the one that's closest to like the hallway itself? Because the one that's like, okay, perfect. So you're the one that's furthest, and I'm going to roll which of those offices it is.
Oh, see.
It's office number 1. Okay, so this office has, you know, like a fairly large window in the thing of it, but it does have a curtain that's pulled down behind it, so you can't see anything inside. There doesn't appear to be a light on inside, and when you jiggle the handle, it is locked.
And the guards are still approaching.
Yeah.
Next down the line.
That's me.
We skip it. I don't think we should break in like right now. I mean, Goose could probably easily break down the door if it's just a normal office door, but like one that'd make
But we have
motion.
Two guards.
Two guards are fucking coming. I know.
We have two guards coming up at us right now.
Okay, so you figure the guards have probably traversed about half of the like they were kind of down like near like the entranceway, like the opposite end of this warehouse. So it's a fairly like long warehouse, probably like a couple hundred feet.
So they're like not really close right now.
It's the crawl. Get into
yeah,
position.
I mean, they're getting there. They're probably about like halfway there. And you guys go up to the second office door. This door has its window about like it's the blinds are halfway up. It's still dark inside there. You can see a bunch of like silhouetted figures that kind of look like they could be, you know, some kind of a tank of some type, like a gas tank of some kind.
Okay. Is there something in the gas tank? No, or.
Well, I mean, you'd have to like open the door or like try opening the door and like investigating it in some way to see whether there's anything in it.
We got to make a decision soon. The guards are going to notice us here. I couldn't stop them.
Hold up.
I couldn't distract him with the questions about the bathroom.
Nicole, take an offensive position. Brendicus and I need to check this room and see what's up.
Yeah, I'm just gonna do... I'm just gonna summon my glaive and take a defensive position. Just when you're getting closer, I'm just gonna go at him. So do I use
create an advantage action?
Yeah. Do you use a fate token to summon the glaive?
I would think so.
No, so what you're doing right now is like the advantage you're trying to create is you're trying to like summon the glaive into your hand and like have like ready and whatever.
Yeah.
So like that's kind of like all in one thing. Since you're taking an action to do it as opposed to like just doing it as part of like another action, like you're basically preparing it. So now in the future, you can use that if you succeed on your roll. As opposed to using a fate token is like in the moment you're like, oh, I need this attack to hit right now. I put this chair earlier or whatever, you know, like I'm just gonna use it immediately. Like I'm gonna like summon my glaive and stab this guy with it like immediately, you know.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, I'm just gonna be summon a glaive and because they are like going to investigate the door, the offices.
Yeah, we're trying to go in the door.
So I'm just gonna like stay close as I can. To the edge, not peeking out so that my snout is like peeking out, just kind of like just having my back towards the wall, just like kind of like waiting and listening to like the footstep, and then when they're like close, I'm just kind of like coming at them like basically.
Okay, so in this case, that's definitely a careful action. That's a careful approach. So you're carefully trying to summon your glaive from, like, me running for it. So yeah. I'm going to say that since it's, like, something that you like, attack someone, which is something that you're pretty good at, I'm going to say that's probably a 2 difficulty. But you're doing a careful approach, which I don't think you're very good at. So
I have nothing in careful.
All right, roll your dice.
Shit. Let's see here. I have 1 success, but I have 1 fail and then 2 blanks. So 0.
Okay, so 0 is a failure.
Yes. I didn't fully understand what the flashing meant, so like, but I know we can really like respec, but yeah, that's fine.
I mean, flash would be like if you're trying to do something that's like big jump and impressive. So like this situation doesn't really call for flashy actions, but like you know if you're trying to do something that gets attention, that's basically flashy.
That's true.
It's like
that's
the
okay.
opposite of like stealthy.
Yeah.
I guess it's not exactly yet. So all right, so in this case you fail.
Yes.
So in this case you just fail. So it just doesn't
Okay.
Doesn't get invoked.
You don't have the glaive. And he's still chilling.
Glaive's not
you there. Basically don't have any like advantage in the further situation. Like you just like try to summon the glaive and like your magic like glitched out or something. Like then, you know, maybe because you were just like knocked unconscious recently or whatever. It's because you're like
not
you're
fine. Like,
you don't only summon the glaive in the heat of battle. You don't have the blood pumping right now. You're sort of like quietly like, all right, come on, glaive, you can summon.
I'm too
like,
cold blooded right now. I'm too cold blooded.
Your spirit right now.
Yeah, I'm just too cold blooded. Not heated up yet.
Exactly. Okay.
So, that's fine. So, I'm just be like, yeah, still leaning against the wall and just waiting. And then at that moment, still do it. But I will probably just use a fate token, I guess, because I failed.
So you want to use a fate token to have your...
Can I do it now? Or?
Yeah, do it does say in the rules that when you fail, you can invoke the aspect if you'd like, but it costs a fate point.
I'll use a fate point.
Okay.
Swing.
There we go.
And then Mark and I check the door for office 2 and swing it open.
Swing it open.
If it's not
swing it open.
We swing it open. If it's not, I'm kicking down this door.
Yeah.
Okay, so get water. This one is unlocked. When you open it, you see a bunch of tanks that have a lot of labels on them that say things like super cold, very careful, like cryo liquid inside, you know, pressurized contents, be careful, like liquid nitrogen, you know, lots of symbols and stuff that you don't fully understand. But
are any of them a tree?
None of them are a tree.
Just making sure Mark's parents' corporation is part of this shit. It's the only symbol I know, all right, geez.
Well, it's cold, but maybe we could hide in here and wait for the guards to pass.
I agree with that.
Okay, so what did you guys do with that first guard's body? Did you ever drag him into a room?
Yeah,
toss him in a room.
Okay, so he's in one of the rooms with the door shut behind him. And then, so you guys are going to, what, try and get Goose's attention and, like, call him back into the room?
I think so.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so you're calling out for me, or just like, kind of like, hey.
Zakraw! Zakraw!
You gotta scream?
Jersey, I'll throw your voice down.
Well, I have to hide quiet down. Cold
room and let the guards pass by.
No, the room's not cold. It's just, it's pressurized. It's cryo gas. So, like,
yeah. The tanks.
It's
tanks
a tank itself. Cold, yeah, like tank
itself. Well, I'm so cold from earlier. this robe, it looks pretty, but it does not have insulation.
All right. I come in with you.
Okay. So you guys are trying to hide this room from the guards, basically?
And then shut the blinds. We shut the blinds, too.
Okay. So you pull down the blind, you shut the door, and you just wait.
Assuming that they're coming in our direction, yeah, I think we want to kind of try to hide in there and wait for them to patrol by for a video game.
Okay. So they're going to walk around the corner, and they're going to see this, like...
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's signs of a struggle. Like you threw him hard up against a wall that he was like knocked unconscious, and there's like a chair that I don't think you said you did anything about.
No, the chair's still there.
Chair's still there. Yeah.
two of the refrigerator doors are still open because you didn't have enough time to go and like shut them, and there's no reason you would shut them after you had opened it.
Yeah, that's perfect. That's perfect. Yeah.
They kind of poke around the corner, and they definitely know that something's up, and you hear the crackle of a radio.
Uh-oh. Oh.
Well, should we keep moving here? If we stay, it's not gonna...
In this room, there's like nothing. There's nothing that leads anywhere else. It's just room.
And cryo tanks. So
there's like out of the tanks, there's a lot of like tubes that seem to be going up and into like a channel in the ceiling, and then going out of the room. But it's unclear where. In the warehouse itself, it's a high-ceilinged warehouse, and so there's a lot of, like, ducts and tubes and stuff going, like, up and down from, like, rooms and, like, across. So, like,
okay.
You know, you didn't have enough time to, like, map it out, but, like, yeah, it seems to be, like, one of these ducts, at least elsewhere in the building.
Okay.
This is, like, a liquid supply room of some type. It kind of seems like maybe it was set up, like, relatively hastily. Like, it's not necessarily, like, the way the room was supposed to be used. Like, there's more tanks in there that seems, like, comfortable to be using.
Well, I'm probably too big for like a duck vent, I presume.
Can someone climb on these tubes? Like to kind of?
No, they're like hoses.
Okay.
That, like, I guess on the outside it would be like a bunch of them together. So like, yeah, you could climb around and like scramble around like, and kind of get up into the scaffolding area up top, you know. Like it's a high-ceilinged warehouse. It has like vent work and like pipes and shit going on above all the rooms.
I think we should act quick on these guards.
Yeah, because that's what I'm thinking. Like, how in distant to us? How far away are they?
So at this point, they've like gone around the corner. So they're probably, and you guys are in the middle office. So they're probably like. I mean, they're definitely within, like, active distance of you. Like, the way that the rules in this game work in terms of movement is basically, like, you divide things up into, like, locations. Like, if you're in a house, be, like, your living room, the front hallway, your dining room, whatever, it'll all be, like, different locations. Mm-hmm. And basically, you can impact anything in your current location or in an adjacent location. Like, you can be, like, I'm going to run the hallway and punch that guy in the face. But you can't run all the way through a house and punch somebody in the face. You can't like run through the kitchen into the living room exactly. and punch somebody.
But we are in distance to like do an action. Go in,
block somebody, you know, whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm gonna
unless you have a ranged weapon, in which way it's like, yeah, I run through the kitchen, I shoot somebody that's in my living room or yeah. something. Like that's
because
no.
that's what I'm trying to think of doing is like
I'm about to short teleport to get the walkie-talkie. One of you guys need to take out the other guy so I don't get 2v1.
Yeah. I get the other one. No problem.
So I'm definitely going to use my last fate point to get that walkie-talkie out of the fucking hand.
ASAP.
So I'm going to say that would be not creating an advantage, overcoming an obstacle. Because the obstacle that you're worried about is like he's going to be using the radio to like indicate that something happened. You hear it like starting to go live. So you're going to like just try and teleport and immediately take care of that.
Yep.
We could do like this. I go in, be this distraction, take one of the guards down. And you go ahead and take the walkie-talkie. Teleport in, get the walkie-talkie.
So I go first in. Or just like a standard, you know, standard hard thing to do. Cause it's like wrestling a radio out of somebody's hand before they, you know, notice it. But you do have the advantage of having used your teleport thing, so you can invoke that aspect to give yourself either a reroll or +2.
It doesn't get advantage if, like, if I'm going in, he's like, "Huh, what the fuck?" I kind of like what, like, kind of like having to walkie-talkie a little bit further away from him, because he's like,
"You could
like what the fuck is this fucking crocodile monster?"
Use your action to give him +1 to the roll. If you can come up with something that you would be doing that would make it like more like likely that he would succeed. You can do that, but it would take your action and give him +1 on the roll.
So right now, it's pretty much just between me using a fate point or getting +2 or getting +1 from you. So I think I should just...
Do I use a fate point or use an action?
No, it just takes your action. So you'd skip your action this turn and would instead just give +1 on Joe's roll. And then Joe can either invoke his aspect, use his teleport power... which would take a fate point to be using as part of another action, or he would just basically like kick open the door. Like he wouldn't use his power, but he would still just like kick open the door and bull rush the guy and try to grab it out of his hands. Which, you know, is also sort of a different approach. Like that's more of a forceful approach. That's not really like a sneaky type approach. You can't really be sneaky about that. I think there's teleporting, he could be sneaky or whatever. Yeah, I don't know what he's good at, but
I want to give him
teleport in there. I need to teleport in there.
Yeah, I will give him an advantage. So use my action to give him like a +1 or like.
Yeah. So what would you be doing to give him the +1? Like, how would you be helping him to accomplish his goal?
I'll be thinking about just like kind of like.
Well, launch him.
Pretty much. Bull rushing the dude without the walkie-talkie for like
a exactly. That's what I wanted to do.
Happening.
Yeah, because I'll be going against the one that's not walkie-talkie, and then he, started with walkie-talkie, be like, "What the fuck's going on?" And then like during that moment, Joe can teleport in.
Okay, so yeah, at the same time as Joe like teleports out and behind the guy, you like kick open the door and are like, "Look at me, I'm a big lizard guy."
Yeah. Like, okay. Cover me.
Quote, unquote.
Yeah. Like, I kind of have my glaive and I'm kind of like stomping. It's like pounding my chest.
Okay. So now, Joe, you need to roll your fate dice. You get to use, I think sneaky is probably what you want to use. I'm not sure what approach.
I'm going to teleport. So if you agree with sneaky, it'd be 3.
Okay, perfect. So you have 3. You get to roll your dice, and you get +1 from Goose Zekral's distraction.
Oof. Looks like 2 negatives and 1 positive, and then a neutral.
So it gives you -1, and then with the +1, so that's neutral. So you get +3, and the difficulty was 4. So that would be a failure to overcome that obstacle. Now you could give yourself the +2, and you would still +2 would give you a success because you go from being -1 to +1 relative to the difficulty. Because like you need to get 4, and you had 3.
Yeah, I want to do that.
So you can give yourself 5 by using okay.
So I have 0 fate points at this moment.
Oh, well, use the last fate point. Shit.
Yeah. It's worth it. They reset.
Yeah. Okay, well, okay.
I mean, we probably have about 20 minutes left here. So
yeah.
So use them up.
Use them
so
up.
So that happened. Boom.
Okay. So you succeed in overcome options. You attain your goal without any cost. So you have the radio in your hand and you click it off. And he didn't get to say anything over the radio and hear him be like, "Hey, I think something's going. What the?"
Yeah.
It's like, you know, this lizard man's up in and you're behind him. And now Mark has an action, and that's the thug's turns.
Okay, so they all charged out of the room, right?
Yeah, we're both out of the room.
Well, Joe teleported.
Okay, so I kind
of
just
like... Well, I was expecting that, yeah, because my thing was just like, I was going out of the room, basically. So they see me in the hallway with them, basically.
Okay, so as Sakral kicks out of the room and the door swings open, I spot an indoor office plant. A potted plant. And I'm like, well, okay, well, you guys got that under control. I'm just gonna... And then I zip and relieve myself in the office plant. and also, I'm kind of muttering like, this is what I think of my parents' corporation, the stupid trees, as I'm kind of peeing on this office plant. And I look over my shoulder and be like, you guys got it. Keep going.
Wow. Oh, wow.
Okay.
This is wild. Also, I'm like, no so, bathrooms in here. Who built this facility?
He didn't go to the bathroom. You would ask about the bathroom. It's too far away. Sweet.
Okay.
That's my action.
So, Garth's turn.
So now it's the.
Mark Zed Way.
The thug's turn.
Corporation. You.
I'm not a fighter, I'm a schemer in crowd control.
Yeah, you're really
I messed,
up where the bathroom
I messed it up. I should have. I had a better idea what I should have said. I should have been like, I hear the boss ordered pizza. It's down in the far lobby.
Pizza. Pizza's here.
Pizza. Holy shit.
Yeah. Too late. I blew it. I blew it for a joke.
Right. It's okay.
Okay. So the one thug that had his radio taken from him by Joe is going to. Turn around and attempt to just attack Joe. He's just gonna come out swinging. So you get to roll your dice for defense.
And then do I add forceful or is it just for defense?
I don't know. Let me double check.
Actually, probably not, because it's called approaches, and I'm not approaching it.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Yeah, so that makes sense. Yeah. I rolled 3 positives and 1 negative.
So okay, so he's... you do plus 2, and he had plus 2 for his baseline, then got 2 negatives, and 1 positive.
Does this count as under pressure 1. Right now?
Under pressure! Ding, 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 ding.
Is this kind of a pressure situation for him?
So, in that case, what you could do is if you were worried that he was going to hurt you, you could, like, use a fate point to invoke doesn't perform well under pressure against that guy, and then you could give him, like, minus 2 to his hit.
Was that a fate point?
Which I can't. Yeah, okay, I get it. Okay, I can't just always be like, ooh.
But he still gets... He has plus 1, and you rolled plus 2, so, he doesn't actually hit you. You're able to defend yourself. You know, he swings at you, and you just block it with the radio or whatever. The other one is going to charge in and try and create an advantage against Drek, whatever your name is. Fuck.
Zakral.
Zakral. By, like, tackling you to the ground.
Is he going to tackle me?
Yep.
Try again, boy! I got like a spikes in his stomach.
So you get to roll your defense die.
All right. So is it 4d6? D6?
Yep.
All right. Um, total of, let's see here. Zero, because I had plus, I got one plus, but then I got one negative and then two neutral or blank. So the total of zero.
Okay, so he is going to successfully tap you to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And are these the same thugs? Same kind of thug?
Null set thug.
Map? Null set thugs, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you say this thug sort of like ran up to you and like managed to like knock you off balance, and so like you sort of like fall backwards after you were like taunting the one guy, and like you were like so excited that you like knocked the hand off the hand, and the other guy just like pushes you over. And now it is back to whoever went first, which I believe was Joe.
Yeah. So I'm going to try and subdue the thug in front of me.
You can spend a fate point. Oh wait, no.
Can I grab the chair and use it as a weapon? Like, is that still in the same room?
Yeah.
And just like attack with it, and would that be like clever, or would that still just be forceful?
I think that'd be forceful. Like, well, let's see.
Either way, I want to attack, so it'd probably be forceful both ways, though it doesn't even matter.
Well, no, I mean, you can attack in ways that aren't necessarily forceful, but yeah, like, I don't think that necessarily, like, grabbing a chair and hitting someone with it counts as clever. Maybe.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of clever, because you're being cleverful by using the environment.
Yeah, like, you could probably do by being, like, you know, I'm, like, you kind of counterattack him or something, so he just attacked you, it makes sense to be like, oh, like, I quickly, like, you know, step aside from his jab or whatever and, like, punch him or something, like, I don't know.
Okay, after the dodge, I do that. I go in for a nice, clean elbow to the face.
Okay, so you roll your attack, I roll my defense.
I have one.
Okay, I got negative one, so I think it means you do two damage. So you just take this guy out. You're able to just like sneak up underneath him and you off him under the chin, his head just like twist the side, and you see him just like completely just like fall over.
Damn,
oh, man. Okay, so now there's a guy who's like standing over you, Zakral, and you are down on the ground.
Yeah. Can I stab him with my tail?
Sure. Yeah, you can attack him.
Yeah, because I'm pretty sure, like...
So stabbing with your tail, I feel like that's kind of, how are you going about doing that?
Unless I can act... Well, that's... Say, like, I'm active my corrosive skin. Is that a fate point, I presume?
Okay.
Or does it cost fate point to do that, or...?
So if you want to invoke the aspect immediately on your current attack,
yeah,
then yes, it costs a fate point. If you want to invoke an aspect to set up, if you're like
setting up,
like for example, last turn you could have used your action to be like, I start exuding like poison slime from my skin, and then later you'd be like, I'm using my free invocation of it to like slam into him with the corrosive skin and do extra damage or something.
Makes
like that.
Sense, yeah, because I wasn't really sure how that worked.
Yeah,
how it would work with like. Stuff like the corrosive skin and stuff like that, how I would set that up. But makes sense that, like, in preparation, like, activated, like, exuding this as acid, and then, like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is there between, like, taking, like, a time to, like, line up a shot and then, like, having a nice shot the next turn?
Yeah.
Versus, like, I just whip out my gun and just, like, from my hip, like, shoot.
In this case, he's already, like, he's already tackling you, so I think you kind of have to, like, spend the...
If you want to just do an attack... without doing anything special and just be like, you're just rolling your attack plus your approach, you can do that at any time without having to use fate points. You don't get any bonus from doing it. It's not like you get plus two from using your glaive unless you use the fate point or you spend an action on a previous turn to like sort of like set yourself or whatever, you know, somehow invoke the aspect.
I was just trying to use my like tail just like kind of like stab him with him.
Okay, like so I will say that's just, you know, regular attack. Yeah. I'll roll my defense die.
Yeah.
Whoa, we should pause real quick here.
Yeah, sorry, Steve. Like, puzzle cake. Yeah, Jesus Christ.
Say stuff.
Dapperwood, thank you so much for 10 gifted subs. Thank you so much, buddy. I highly appreciate it. Thank you so much. Hi, Dapperwood, hope you're doing all right. We have an awesome evening.
Yes, oh. Welcome Dapperwood to our role play session here. We're doing the fake system role playing superheroes. Just about the end of our session. But holy poo-poo. Mr. Asian Face got one? Aw, oh, shit.
God damn it. Ah, shit. Yeah, let's go. For some reason, I turned off the alerts, but for some reason it still pops up. I don't know why.
That's okay. As long as it's the audio.
Just want to make sure that at least one that is over, we can continue. I think we'll go. May no rules ever be neutral. Thank you so much, support team. Thank you so much, Dapper. I really appreciate it a lot. Thank you so much, buddy. Thank you so much. It's okay. It's okay, Dapper. It's okay, Dapper. It's all good. It's all good. Sorry. Yeah. Yes. Oh, okay. Continue. Yeah. So straight attack. So four. Yeah. Let's see here. Goddamn! Like I roll horribly. Yeah. So two minus and just one success. So
that's one
negative
total.
One.
Negative one. Okay. So you don't. It's negative one.
Yeah. Because the fourth one is neutral. So yeah.
Mhm.
Yeah. I'm better with D10s, not D6s. Oh. I gotta use my fate point to kind of make him explode.
Yeah, so you just miss. You're not able to do any attack to him.
Okay, so nothing like, yeah, nothing negative in that way happens if I have negative.
If he was able to defend and got plus three or more, like he was able to defend three more damage than you did.
I stab myself.
He would just get a boost, so he'd get a bonus to a later thing, but whatever.
Okay.
So is it me?
Yes.
All right. Well, I'm watching this all go down. I just finished peeing in this potted plant here. I'm feeling a lot better. And I say, oh no, it's not going so well. It looks like I gotta get my hands dirty. And I pick up a different potted plant that doesn't have pee in it.
Okay.
I grab it and I'm charging. I'm kind of just moving over and I go to smack the guy in the head with the potted plant.
All right, let's roll your attack. So I'd say that's
pretty forceful. Yeah.
So you're just running up and hitting a guy with a plant. I mean, that's...
Is that flashy?
Oh, did I get to use my force? Is that forceful? It doesn't happen.
Okay, so I'd say flashy would be more like if you try to do something, you know, like flashy with it. Like you take the plant and like
throw it up in the air.
Like you
drop kick the vase.
And I'm like, hey, look at me. And so like drops his head or something. Like, I don't know. Something like.
Okay.
Not
okay.
Just like. Like that's forceful. That's like direct. Yeah. Just like hitting someone with it.
I'm gonna go with that.
Okay.
Grabbing the potted plant and just trying to bash him on the head.
Okay. So roll your attack.
One off the table. Okay, so I have one negative, one positive, and then neutral.
No, what's your baseline?
Zero.
Okay.
So nothing. So, yeah, this thug is awesome. He's like,
you miss with the potted plant, and this guy just like looks at you like, what the heck's going on here?
All right.
So see, all three of you have gone. So I think it's his turn again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he's just gonna try and just fucking punch you, Zekrol, I think.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He feels like you guys are just like, I don't know, like just unable to fight right now. So, all right. But he does. Let's see. So you get to roll your defense.
I got two success and two. Success.
Okay, so he is unable to harm you, and you can see that he kind of looks a little scared.
Oh,
and
fuck like, yeah.
Punches you, and it just doesn't do a thing. Like it hits one of those things, you're
yeah.
just like,
exactly.
Like, oh. Hurt either of you really. You're just like, what yeah. the fuck?
Yeah. Okay. So nice now try.
Back around to.
Was there maybe dirt in his eyes at all? That caused him to miss.
No, definitely not. No, no, he hit.
Oh, okay, he hit.
Yeah, yeah, no, I'm sorry. It was no dirt in his eyes from your potted plant. It did nothing okay. at all. You just okay. completely whiffed.
My hands are whiffed. No,
it's my scales.
Okay, so now I guess we're back to Joe. He was first, I think. Yeah.
I think, yep. yeah. I mean, technically, I think it was me, but we can go with Joe first.
Well, I think it's swapped.
If I recall correctly, it was swap. Joe who... Whatever.
I got teleported up.
Okay,
yeah, you
okay.
teleported out.
Okay, never mind.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just gonna...
Fucking karate shop his ass.
Yeah, coming from behind, rear naked choke, and just try to choke him out.
Unfortunately, forcefully, because I only got one.
I mean, I think you could probably do that sneaky. Like, if he's distracted punching your friend, you have to be able to come up with a way to, like, sneakily do something to him, right?
Yeah, I can't... I mean, I guess that's up to you, because I like rear naked choke, just like he is like facing away from me, so definitely just like I could be sneaking up, but then it kind of gets forceful if I'm like trying to choke him out. You know what I mean?
Okay, I'll let it be sneaky though, because like you're sneaking up to him, like you're getting a sneak attack on him. I'll let that slide for now. You know, we'll see how that goes.
I also okay, go ahead, pick roll. Up a plant.
Choke it with the plant.
The one that does have peanut.
Okay, so let's see how much damage you do. You roll your attack?
Yeah. Three positives, one negative.
So two. Three positives, so you get plus two, and then you get, so yeah, you choke this guy like almost too aggressively choke him out.
Pop a snake.
Like you think you feel something pop in there. Like, it doesn't seem like he's dead, but
oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
J03, be careful. Oh.
Oh, nice.
Now my stomach is off.
I like the sound of popping, Nyx.
Sorry, I didn't expect to be the only one taking out guys here. Jesus.
Well, I'm gonna go
I
do
hope
something.
You're relieved because we have much more to do.
I am relieved. I'm not much of a fighter, but now I can at least use my powers with a clear head and not thinking about the bathroom all the time.
Thank God.
So all right, I think this is probably a good time to at least I need to log off because I need to leave.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. Just like pause it here or stop it here, basically.
Yeah, so I don't know. I'm probably not going to be able to do this again necessarily like next week, but I will definitely be in touch. Okay. We can figure out the next time we'll be able to do this and figure out how frequently we'll be able to do it. Maybe every other week, maybe every 3 weeks or something. We'll figure it out.
Yeah, that's fine. Pretty much this is just something that we'll have in the rotation. We're always mixing it up in the Good Ship podcast. Okay. So thank you so much, Steve Pewter.
Thank you so much, Steve.
I'll let you disconnect. Much appreciated. Yeah. I had a great time. That was awesome.
Yep.
Yeah.
Same here. Enjoyed that. Set up so
great learning it.
I've been waiting such a long time to do this. Yeah. It's so exciting to finally do it. Oh my
a couple
God.
Like yeah, you know,
patience with me as I learn this new system and everything because we're all learning together. So
I mean, we all learn this together
smoother as it goes on. Like, we already started figuring stuff out, you know, like there's
exactly
not, there's yeah. not too much to it, just like it's hard to learn until you try it. So,
exactly. I mean, we all learn together, and I think it's a nice experience to do it. So, yeah, mm-hmm.
Well, I had fun with you guys. I'll see you later.
Let's talk to you later. See you.
Thanks,
bye-bye.
See you, everybody.
Bye.
Damn. So triggered in my entire life.
I've been triggered.
Fucking Prendicus over here. Not asking good questions.
Okay, I messed that up. I should have said
the dead weight of the group.
We've only been.
I know.
This has been pure combat. There's not many. I mean, I messed up my one time to shine. I messed it up. At least it looked cool. But
you
I didn't think
cool.
I was under pressure. I was going to be like, because I didn't know if the goons knew like what the boss is up to. So I didn't want to be like, stand out. But what I should have said was, oh, I heard they ordered a pizza.
just get him off our trail.
Yeah, he's kind of like
something to get him away. But instead, I was just like, oh, I can't think of anything else. I'm just gonna make a joke.
Yeah.
So
that's fine. That's okay. I mean, I botched so many like my rules. I was like, that was fucking horrible. Then yeah, but that's just the way things are. This is just the luck of the dice and stuff like that. Nothing you can do about it. But I still had a lot of fun.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. Well, we'll try to. Patience and Greenfish, thank you for hanging out with us. Anyone else kicking around?
Thank you, everybody.
With those gift subs, thank you. Anyone lurking for us, much appreciated. We're kind of dependent on Steve a little bit with the scheduling.
Yeah.
But we'll try to either send out a tweet or maybe Goose will post something. Maybe if we have our next confirmed date, Goose will put something in the Discord so people know, because it might not be every Sunday.
Yeah.
But either way, every Sunday, for the most part, the three of us will be here doing something.
Doing a good shit podcast. So, yeah.
Thank you, Brave Wild Sarah, still lurking. Appreciate that.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
I should, Pocket Dirt would have been cool.
It is like, you should have like, Pocket Dirt.
Sometimes, yeah.
That creates an aspect you can use later.
Yeah.
Now I understand how aspect works.
Yeah, once we learn the system, we'll be able to like, actually create better plans and whatnot and,
Yeah,
because that was a good idea to like pick up a plan. Like you like created the what C was saying is how we can like create what's around us, kind of and, like go off of it.
Yeah.
So if we need to play off.
We're helping narrating the story as kind of like the environment stuff like that. So I think that's pretty cool to have it like that. I mean, it is basically just a like you making everything up on the spot, like. Literally everything. There's no baseline system like D&D. We have like a set amount of like a universe, characters, classes, weapons, and everything. Like here is just like you make up whatever you want to make up. It's up to you. Whatever.
Yeah, the players like D&D. It's kind of more like okay, you know, 80% of the storytelling in the world and the environments in the DM's hand. Well, this game is like more collaborative between like the game master and the players.
Yeah, exactly.
So like I didn't say, hey Steve, can I search the room and see if any potted plants are around? I'm just like, oh, we're in an office, there's a potted plant.
Yeah, there's gotta be a potted plant, like there's obviously
more than one.
So
I pissed in one of them
and then I take the other one and try and smack the guard.
I should have grabbed like a handful of dirt and like
throw it at them.
Pocket dirt.
See, that,
green
that, that would have been clever. You probably have like a 2 or 1 in clever.
But I don't understand. Like, when I tried to punch him, was I not able to use my forceful attitude?
No, you're supposed to, I think, because that was definitely just like a forceful attack.
Yeah, I was like, because then I could add my +3, but then it's like, well, I didn't understand that.
Yeah, the only time you don't use those is like if you're like reacting to like.
Yeah, makes sense. So I should have added those +3. So it should have been a 2 at least. But it's whatever.
Yeah, and so we have just a little like side note. There's some characters, some other heroes that are also in this with us. I don't know, do Goose or Joe? Do you know who Sugar Glider is?
No, that's
or Ant Carrier. I don't remember.
Arachno Boy.
Arachno Boy.
It kind of sounds like A-Rad. Maybe, I don't know, maybe if we unmask Arachno Boy, it could be A-Rad. Maybe you get Greenfish as Sugar Glider. Maybe Brave Wild Sarah actually is the Equalizer, the main villain. We don't know.
And Hawkeye could be, I don't know. Could be Dapperwood.
Dapperwood, right?
Yeah.
I think Hawkeye's a bad guy, dude. I'm going to be totally straight.
I mean, he brought us here. He invited us to this trap.
But he was also unconscious, like he got hit by the but it could be a setup. I know. It's a setup that he's trying to be like, I'm innocent, I'm innocent, but he's not fucking innocent. Like
the killer was in the room the whole time.
Spoiler. I'm gonna fucking activate my acid fist, and he's gonna like burn his face out, like melt his face away. Like, oh no.
Yeah, man, I think I'm just gonna use up them fate points every.
I mean, if they recharge by the time we
every time we do a session, we get our free fate points back. So there are ways to get fate points as well.
Yeah, he can like award them to you.
Yeah,
I got to think of ways to be more flashy.
Yeah, I never really understood flashy. Right. I think, I don't know, we can see, because I kind of like, I don't want flashy. Well, I don't know why I put flashy there. As a...
You can probably change. I mean, I'm three flashy. Because
it doesn't make sense. You're like, why the fuck do I have flashy? Like, I don't know. It makes no
you're
sense.
You're probably force. Let me see your stats.
Look at my stats.
You're force for three. Oh, your flashy is two?
Yeah, that's why, like, it doesn't make sense to have two flashy. Why the fuck do I have two flashy? Doesn't know nothing.
I mean, maybe, like, maybe increase clever by one. Make clever your two, and then make
yeah,
flashy
exactly. That's
one.
What I'm gonna try to do. Clever two, and then careful. Yeah.
So Joe is sneaky three. I'm flashy three. You're forceful three. Seems pretty good.
Yeah, it makes sense. Because I kind of looked over like, yeah, you have three in sneaking. You have three in flashy.
We got a question here coming in from the chat from Patience Draft. Mark, does your beard get bedhead?
Bedhead?
No, not really. I don't know. Not really. I mean, it can kind of like, it can kind of get like pushed down.
Oh,
like if
okay.
I'm like wearing like a coat or something and it like comes up. I don't know. It doesn't, not really bedhead.
Okay.
they got that cleared up.
I don't know what bedhead is, but that's pretty sweet.
You know, like when you wake up and you got a bad hair day.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And you got to comb your hair.
Gotcha. Makes sense. Okay, makes sense.
Hermance, welcome back.
Hermance, salut, Hermance. Yes, Stepperwood gave you.
Maybe Hawkeye is Hermance.
Yeah. Yeah, Hawkeye is probably Hermance. Yeah. Like, oh, salute, man.
Or maybe Hermance was that guard that we just
like fucking annihilated.
Annihilated in the beginning.
That I punched fucking like punched his face in.
Yeah, so I do have one of those VR headsets. I snagged that.
Yeah, that was smart.
Yeah.
Doing stuff like that.
That was clever.
Oh. He's doing it now.
He's doing it now. Well, thank you everybody so much for hanging out on today's stream and podcast. And huge thank you to my host Mark Zombie and co-host Yo Zombie 93, and of course our DM STEVEPUTER. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
Real life friend of Joe and I is there, STEVEPUTER. It's pretty.
Yep.
It's gonna be possible without him. So.
Exactly.
Yeah, true that.
It makes Somar makes an awesome job, I feel.
Yeah.
Definitely helps out, like feeling the.
That
it's
awesome.
Yeah, feeling everything is alive, and
he's got everything mapped out. He's got something juicy.
That was cool. He should take a photo of that and then have it like uploaded. So I can show the map maybe like for everybody.
I mean, yeah,
that'd be cool.
And I don't know if you have like any like kind of music going on in the background, Goose.
I have some just like some synth wave in the background, but I was thinking adding some like. You know, like having some tab for like combat music and some tab for like ambient, like prison or something. Because I was thinking about that, but then as we were going through with the role playing, that kind of like went away because I was focused on role playing. So I think that's kind of like help out everybody to kind of like get the feeling what's going on in environment, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. All right, shall we do? If you guys have a spare moment, we're going to be ending here, but we're going to look for a raid victim. We have a raid call. It looks a little bit like this. Even if you don't have the goose emote, still honor him or use your own emotes. Booty up.
Booty up, goose raid. You still honor me. Make me very happy if I saw that. Copy pasted. Once we're heading over to someone here, I'm thinking. I am thinking. Let's see here. There's someone I've been meaning to raid for a very good while, and we'll have a good opportunity now. Thinking about Rico Coster to raid Rico Coster. He's playing some Smash Ultimate right now with some viewers, I presume. Yeah, with some viewers. I think we're gonna go ahead and send a big booty goosey onto his way here. So let's see, Rico Coster. There we go.
Oh hell yeah.
Thank you once again, everybody, for hanging out. And yeah, we'll see y'all
until next time.
Yep. Take care, buddy. Bye-bye. Bye.
Money.